Good morning.
Good morning.
Let's keep the chatter down, all right? All right, in keeping with our normal practice, we're gonna go through the announcements real quick. I'm hoping that Mike's got them on the board up here so that you can read them yourself. There's a board meeting tomorrow night, so let's try and get there for that. November 19th, Alex Jolt has confirmed that he'll be here. Now, I realize that seems like a long ways away, but knowing how fast time flies now, it's not really all that far away, so let's be here for that, because Alex is a swell guy. And why does it have to be on the 19th? Why does he do that? We need to teach him to deer hunt, okay? We need to teach the guy, give him a gun, and show him how to shoot a deer, so that he doesn't do this. Or did you do this? All right. I'm going to tell him that. I'm going to take you hunting so you can find out the joys of God's green earth and what it's like to feed yourself so that you don't have to cop into my spot, you know? All right. Carol has put a request in here, and I want to ask all of you to bear this burden, okay? If anyone would like to share their talent, now, you don't have to be terribly talented to share your sincerity about your faith. So, whether you can sing well or not, we don't care. We care about your sincerity. So we want to ask, if you have a talent, you can play a guitar, you can play a drum, you can do anything, please share it with us. Share it with us. I like that. I don't think Tom wants to be the only entertainer here. And I don't want to be the only guy singing all the time. And we can't constantly ask Joy to come and sing all the time, or Matt, or whoever. So if you can sing and you want to just express yourself and your faith, please, please do that. All right. Yes, there is a ton of bread downstairs. Please help yourselves and give it to people who need it, or if you need it, eat it. Okay? Generally, that's what I would do with it is, you know, I have needs too. Okay, well, that's what I'm going to say for the announcements. If you guys are missing something, then you need to read it in here or ask Carol or whoever. And right now we're going to do our meet and greet. So please walk across the aisle. We have some visitors here from California, some friends of Carol and Dave's. Carol's, I think you guys were like from third grade, you've been friends? Okay. What? I won't go anywhere with that. It's going to make you feel a lot older than me. So please walk across the aisle and greet everybody in the name of the Lord.
Thank you.
once somebody said something this morning about, you know, how long are we going to be here? And it wasn't me. So I will do my best to get us out of here at a reasonable time so we can beat the crowds to the lunches. A bus driver on his route sees a van from the zoo stranded on the side of the road. The zoo worker offers the bus driver $100 to help him deliver 24 penguins. So the bus driver agrees and loads the penguins on the bus, and an hour later the zoo worker gets his van fixed and heads to the zoo. On the road, he sees the bus driver and the penguins driving in the opposite direction. So he catches up to the bus and pulls him over. The zoo worker yells, "I gave you $100 to take the penguins to the zoo for me. Why are you still driving them around?" "Calm down," says the bus driver. "I took the penguins to the zoo and we had change left over, so we're going to the movies." You might have saw that one coming. There was these three guys talking. Two of them were talking about the amount of control they have over their wives, while the third guy remains quiet. After a while, one of the first two turns to the third and says, "Well, what about you? What sort of control do you have over your wife?" The third fellow puffs out and says, "Well, I'll tell you, just the other night, my wife came crawling to me on her hands and knees." The first two guys were amazed. Their eyes are wide and they have a newfound respect for this man. "Wow, what happened then?" they asked. The third fellow sighed and uttered, she said, "Get out from under the bed and fight like a man." An older couple had a son who was still living with them. The parents were a little worried as the son was still unable to decide about his future career, so they decided to do a small test. They put a note on the front hall table that they had left. Around the note, they put a $10 bill, a Bible, and a bottle of whiskey, and then they hid, pretending that they were not home. The father told his wife, "If our son takes the money, he'll be a businessman. If he takes the Bible, he'll be a pastor. But if he takes the bottle of whiskey, I'm afraid our son will be a no-good drunk." So the parents hid in the nearby closet and waited nervously. Peeping through the keyhole, they saw their son arrive. He read the note that they had left. Then he took the $10 bill, looked at it against the light, and slid it in his pocket. After that, he took the Bible, flipped through it, and put it under his arm. Finally, he grabbed the bottle, opened it, and took an appreciative whiff to be assured of its quality. Then he left the room carrying all three items. The father slapped his forehead and said, "This is the worst thing I could ever imagine." "What?" asked the wife. "Our son's going to be a politician." Father's Day is coming up, and so while I was thinking about doing this, I thought, you know, this is a perfect chance to talk about my dad, and I warned him last week that I was going to talk about him. As I got going into kind of preparing for this, I realized that there's some things that I had thought about telling you about, specific instances of my life and his together, that I can't share with you. There are things that I will tell you, but a lot of this is extremely personal. It's very personal. And the title of the message on the front of this, it says, "Things My Dad Never Taught Me." But the title was supposed to be, "The Preacher's Kid and His Dad." And the theme of it is, the things that he taught me that he never really went out of his way to explain or teach. So with that in mind, just bear that in mind when we get going here. Right now we're going to worship. We're going to sing. And there's a new YouTube song called Forever that we're going to sing. I don't even know if I've heard this one or not. So let's get that going. Please stand and let's get worshiping the Lord.
Yeah.
the back of this bulletin right here is a mountain of stuff. It's a lot of people to pray for. Grandma Louise, always thinking about her. I think about her a lot during the week. It's funny that I don't see her very often, but she pops into my head all the time, and I always think the same thing. What a sweet, just a beautiful, just a beautiful spirit. You know, I think about her a lot. Ray and Pat, obviously. This says, Pat fell and hit her head, and is bleeding in the brain? Yeah. Oh my gosh. Okay. Well, we're going to pray for him for sure. Yes. Them. Indeed. Does anybody else have anything they need to add to this list? I see Elaine says she's doing very well now. She feels great. And that's awesome. That's very good.
Just need to gain weight.
Yeah, well, I told you, man, pizza, and I'm telling you, Burger King, Wendy's. Oh, listen to you. Wow, you're asking for it really bad, I think. Go ahead. This question, however many number of people there are in here, that's how many unspoken requests there are. And I know that all of you have needs. I know that all of you have things that only God can provide to you. And so I think about that a lot every time I ask that question. It's like there's 30 more unspoken ones sitting here. And so we blanket it all and just try to have God bless us and sit with us while we ponder those things together. And you don't ever have to tell us because God already knows. So if nobody else has anything, let's take all of this stuff to Him. Lord Jesus, we thank You for such a beautiful day. We thank You for meeting new friends. We thank You for seeing old ones that we worry about and haven't seen in a while. And Lord, there's so many faces that we do not have here with us today. Only You know their real issues and the things going on in their lives, but we pray for them, for these unspokens that we just spoke about. Lord, there are family members of all of ours out there that struggle with addictions, and, like many of us, things that only You can cure, only You can provide the guidance. And I ask, Lord, that You would work in all of those lives to help them see that seeking an answer anywhere but You is futile. We thank You, Lord, for our fathers. There are many among us and around us that have no relationship to speak of with a dad who cared and loved, at least not anything like You did for us. And I pray that You would bless the dads, all of them. We pray for Ray and Pat. Lord, just thank You for them. They're such a blessing to us, and we haven't seen them in such a long time, but the light that they showed when they were here still shines. And we ask that You sit with them today. We pray for peace in our nation, and that we would come to grips with some of the turmoil that's around us, the hypocrisy that we see that just never seems to go away. I thank You, Lord, my son found a home, and that his family is blossoming now. And I thank You for Tim being with us today. And I ask that You would sit with him. There's so many things, Lord. So many things that seem like this mountain. We don't even know where to start sometimes. But You do. So all the things that weren't said, Lord, I pray that You would scoop those up and take them with You and put Your hand in each situation, regardless of what it is. And for the things that we have talked about,
pray that you would grab those up and show us some of your true power and your ability. We know you can, Lord, we just ask what you will. So in your name, Lord, amen.
All right. Now it's time to not take an offering. I think we're past that stage, you know. But God has been good to us. So, that being said, if Carol, you would bless us with your day by day. Play to you.
What is appropriate to sound doctrine. Teach the older men to be temperate, worthy of respect, self-control, and sound in faith and love and endurance. Likewise, teach the older women to be reverent in the way they live, not to be slanderous or addicted to much wine, but to teach what is good. Then they can urge the younger women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled and pure, to be busy at home, to be kind, and to be subject to their husbands, so that no one will malign the word of God. Similarly, encourage the young men to be self-controlled, and everything set them an example by doing what is good. In your teaching, show integrity, seriousness, and soundness of speech that cannot be condemned, so that those who oppose you may be ashamed because they have nothing bad to say about this.
Thank you very much. All right. Did I skip something? I did, didn't I?
Yeah, let's sing that.
Yeah. Day by day, I think I missed. I thought we were singing that. All right, I'm sorry. All right. Okay, I'm on the wrong page. Why? That's my problem. There we go. Been on the wrong page for a long time, man. Took a long time to get on the right page. All right, please stand and let's sing Wonderful Grace of Jesus.
Yeah. wonderful the matchless grace of Jesus, deeper than the mighty moving sea, higher than the mountains, sparkling like a fountain.
Softball team on a weekday athlete. I mean, he was an athlete. He was extremely active. I imagine he played softball two or three nights a week. I remember regularly as a kid seeing his picture in the paper for hitting home runs on his fast pitch softball team. Now, I don't know if you've ever played fast pitch softball, but it is very intense. It's played like baseball on a softball field, which is much shorter. And some of these guys that are pitching are throwing a ball harder than a guy throwing overhand. And it's intense. And I tried it. And I was not nearly as good at this as he was. But he was very active. The one thing that he could not teach me about being an athlete was to have a competitive fire. So the pain didn't matter. You didn't care. You wanted to win. That was the drive, is to win, win. You got to win. You always, and he talked about it recently. If God can be less than a loss, how much better if you win? And you strive for it, and he practiced. My father was a golfer. He played tennis. He played football. It's funny, when I was a kid, I remember going to high school football games while he reffed. And he beat the kid to the end zone to make the call. He outran him. Maybe he outran him. Obviously, his golf swing is not the same. His softball career is over, and all of those things, but my dad was an athlete. And he tried to teach me to play golf one day, and this is where this started for me on this particular message, is this one thing, and this is more of a physical type thing, but to give me instruction, all right, keep your left arm straight, keep your knees bent, stay on the balls of your feet, keep your head down. You're trying to concentrate on all of these things, and I couldn't do it. But what I figured out, I watched him, and I watched what he did, and I mimicked the movement and made that one perfect swing to try and figure it out. Now, obviously, he's sort of lost some of that now, but the point is that by doing that, it worked. All of that left arm straight, knees bent, it's like, well, if I don't do, and I had to figure it out for myself. Which is going to be a common theme through this, that I had to figure it out for myself. It wasn't something that, even though he tried to teach me, until I went out and tried it myself, I didn't get it. It's funny, this when I started looking into this, I got into Titus and I thought, wow, this is crazy, because every single thing that I want to tell you about my dad in a positive light is on two pages. Two pages. I didn't have to float around. I didn't have to look for anything else. It's like, wow. Initially, as I got into this too, it was about the things he didn't intend to teach. And obviously, all of us have parents. We all know that their parents have shortcomings, and I am not an exception. I have sat with my father through some of the most emotional things that he will ever go through. And this strong pillar of faith, this man who admonished me from day one, cried, what do I do? Asking a 20-year-old kid, what do I do? And this is one of the things that he taught me that he didn't intend or he didn't tell me. My dad, despite his position for and with you, is a man. He's a regular man. He has desires. He has thoughts. He's a sinner just like you and me, and Jesus died for him the same way. The expectation that was put upon me as a young man to be this perfect young man who was the preacher's son, I really let him down. I spent a lot of time proving to all the rest of the world that I was just like them, and it worked. I would dare say that part of the reason that we had to move to Muskegon was because how do you impose God's word and the laws of this book on people when you can't get your son to shut up or to stop spray painting things that don't belong or being in places that he isn't supposed to be or doing the things that I was doing in a community that is very close? I walked into a dance one time in the seventh grade just to tell my friend his mother was outside, and before I got home, my old man wanted to know, what were you doing at the dance? And just so you know, for all the older crowd, when I say old man, that is an affectionate term to me. It's an affectionate term to me. It is not a disrespectful thing. I love that man with all my heart. My father used to walk me through the Proverbs all the time, and when I knew I was going to do this, there's one that I absolutely have to share. He did his best. Proverbs chapter 4. I'm going to read the whole thing. I couldn't stop at just a couple of verses. I had to read the whole thing. Listen, my son, to a father's instruction. Pay attention and gain understanding, because I give you sound learning. So don't forsake my teaching. For I too was a son to my father, still tender and cherished by my mother. Then he taught me, and he said to me, take hold of my words with all your heart and keep my commands, and you will live. Get wisdom, get understanding, and do not forget my words or turn away from them. Do not forsake wisdom, because she will protect you. Love her, and she will watch over you. The beginning of wisdom is this. Get wisdom, though it costs all. You have. Get understanding. Cherish her and she will exalt you. Embrace her and she will honor you. She will give you a garland to grace your head and present you with a glorious crown. Listen, my son, accept what I say, and the years of your life will be many. I instruct you in the way of wisdom and lead you along strong paths. When you walk, your steps will not be hampered. When you run, you will not stumble. Hold on to instruction. Do not let it go. And guard it well, for it is your life. Do not set foot on the path of the wicked or walk in the way of evildoers. Avoid it. Do not travel on it. Turn from it and go your way. For they cannot rest until they do evil. They are robbed of sleep until they make someone stumble. They eat the bread of wickedness and drink the wine of violence. The path of the righteous is like the morning sun, shining ever brighter till the full light of day. But the way of the wicked is like deep darkness, and they don't even know what makes them stumble. My son, pay attention to what I say. Turn your ear to my words. Do not let them out of your sight. Keep them within your heart, for they are life to those who find them, and health to one's whole body. Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. Keep your mouth free of perversity. Keep corrupt talk far from your lips. Let your eyes look straight ahead and fix your gaze directly before you. Be careful, give careful thought to the paths of your feet, and be steadfast in all your ways. Do not turn to the right or to the left, and keep your foot from evil. I must have read that 35, 40 times with my dad. You guys know that when I was young, and when I started high school, he woke me up every morning. We read one of these Proverbs every day, every month, for that entire year. And just like my mother said, things will change, and you will change. And I did. And then I let other people influence my life. And I started thinking, how could my dad possibly know what my friends are like and what it's like out there to do what I do? He doesn't know my friends. He doesn't know the situation. He's never tried any of this. And as I've said before, you don't have to jump off the edge of the cliff to know it's going to hurt at the bottom. He knew that, because it says so here. In the same book of Titus, I'm going to get this a little out of order, chapter 1, starting in verse 10, and this was me, this is why my dad does what he does. For there are many rebellious people full of meaningless talk and deception, especially those of the circumcised group. They must be silenced because they are disrupting whole households by teaching things they ought not to teach. I'm going to stop right there because I thought as a preacher's son that I had it all figured out. So when people would ask me questions, I would answer in whatever I thought was best. And this is many, 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 many years ago. I actually told a guy one time that the Bible said, thou shalt not partake of any alcoholic beverage. Now that's just silly. The fact of the matter is, God didn't say don't drink. He says don't be drunk. Don't be controlled by it. The point is that I wasn't handling it responsibly. And that for the sake of a dishonest gain, one of the Crete's own prophets has said, Cretans are always liars, evil, and brutes, lazy gluttons. This saying is true. Therefore rebuke them sharply so that they will be sound in the faith and will pay no attention to the Jewish myths or to the merely human commands of those who reject the truth. To the pure, all things are pure, but to those who are corrupted and do not believe, nothing is pure. In fact, both their minds and consciences are corrupted. And this one's a little bit hard to take. They claim to know God, but by their actions, they deny Him. They are detestable, disobedient, and unfit for doing anything good. They claim to know God, but their actions deny Him. As I said, my dad's a regular guy. He's just a person. Now, I have him on this pedestal way, way up here as being a Superman of faith. And I used to wonder all the time what it would be like when he's not around. How would I maintain my walk with God without Him? But He taught me so well without saying anything that I already know how that's going to play out. I have a standing appointment with Jesus every morning, and many times during the day, I am thinking to myself, Lord, you need to help me with this because I don't know what to say to this guy. I don't know what to say about this. My father taught me that to urge people to make decisions not based on their heart or based on what the world would tell them is okay, but to look in God's Word and ask the question to Him and then seek the answer, not from someone else, but from God. Many of us in the room have, at some point in time, been married to someone you shouldn't have been married to. Guilty. Never dawned on me to sit with Jesus and say, is this the right person? Should I be here right now? I had to take what my dad told me and learn the hard way because I went the other direction. My father has gone out of his way to build the kingdom of heaven. And I know him as a man, and there are times in his life where he would, I can't even imagine how hard it must have been for him to sit here even maybe and just look up at God and say, I did everything you said. And this kid's an idiot. I remember the look on his face when I got out of jail one morning. I came home. And he didn't want to talk to me. This is just before I went to rehab. Actually, it's several years before I went to rehab. This is kind of the beginning. He didn't want to talk to me, and I was hurt by that. I remember him asking me some questions about it, and that was pretty much all we said, and I went on my way. I know that on one occasion, I decided that I was going to have a party at home. And I mean a party. I did some serious entertaining. There was lots of beer. I allowed people to smoke cigars and cigarettes in the house. That was the epitome of rebellion right there, is smoking in the house. That was just taboo. You don't do that. They came home early. In my inebriated state, Dad and I began to argue in my bedroom for all my friends to hear. I could see a look on his face. In the middle of that argument, I told him, go ahead, hit me. And I was screaming at him, hit me, I want you to hit me, because I wanted to hit him. And I saw his shoulders drop. And the look on his face, and he said, Tim, I don't want to hit you. I love you. And he turned around and he walked out. It's a look that I will never forget. And I knew I was in the wrong. You would think at that moment that I would have thought, I need to change. No, I sent my friends home and cleaned up, but nothing changed. We didn't communicate very well. I was still just the selfish punk that I was. I wanted to meet the next party. I had the same feeling about another instance, and this one's really tough. When my son was little, my first son, Joey, my sister and my brother-in-law watched our kids often at the time. I was separated from my first wife, and I was in the middle of the party scene, and you know, once the party stops, you know, the marriage is kind of, you have to work at it, and there was no fixing that one. I went to take some diapers to my sister's house, and there was my brother-in-law standing with my son in the driveway. The kid had a pacifier in his mouth. And I had every opportunity to be with that kid. And typical, there was a party to get to. And I can still see that boy with his big eyes and that pacifier in his mouth watching me, wondering, where are you going? Aren't you important? My dad made me feel important. He taught me how to throw a ball. He taught me how to swing a bat. And he did it rather impatiently sometimes. My dad was a very emotional person, particularly on Sundays. He used to be. He was very nervous on Sunday. Just like I don't generally get as nervous as he did, because I don't mind being in front of people. My wife says I like attention. I don't know if that's totally true or not. I just like making people smile. But my father was always rather grumpy on Sunday. He was very, very nervous. And so you didn't want to talk back on a Sunday morning, and you didn't want to get in his bad graces on Sunday morning, because it meant that the Sunday afternoon was going to be a little rough. But he taught me all of those things, how to make good judgment, and I ignored him. And I owe the man a lot. I saw a lot of what not to do, and that's those personal things that I can't necessarily share with everybody, because we all have that. We all have that. And it's not, I can stand here and confess my sins all day long, but not other people. I have more respect for that man than probably anyone on the planet, because of what he tolerated and put up with just for me. That doesn't count my other brothers and sisters. They got away with a lot more, because I think eventually he figured out, well, he's turning out okay, so they'll probably be all right too. I don't know. Or they were just better at sneaking. That's the gist I got of it. Tom was a master at negotiating out of punishment, and I learned from that. So my little brother taught me some stuff too. But what it boils down to is that My dad speaks with authority. He knows. He's a wise man. He's a very wise man. I'm going to read a different part of the verses that we read this morning in Titus, same book, chapter 2, starting in verse 11. For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly possessions, worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, godly lives in this present age, while we wait for His blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave Himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for Himself a people that are His own, eager to do what is good. These, then, are the things you should teach. Encourage and rebuke with all authority, and do not let anyone despise you. When my father talks up here, he knows what he's talking about, and he means it, and he is the authority. And I'm not talking about, you know, the old, back in the day, in the early 70s, ADD didn't exist, and if it did, this was your Ritalin. My father used this to play paddleball, racquetball, as part of his athletic stuff, and clearly he warmed up on me. And I gave him every opportunity. There are people out there who will take a long time to learn. I've had to go to my own sons and apologize for exactly what I was telling you about, not giving them that time and being a part-time, when it's convenient for me, parent. And that's, I think, a big thing when you've got two separate parents who are not together. You might always have that. There's a dynamic there that you, a bridge that has to be gapped. And it's a tough one to bridge when the two of you don't get along. Titus chapter 3. Remind the people to be subject to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready to do whatever is good, to slander no one, to be peaceable and considerate, and always be gentle towards everyone. Being gentle towards everyone is kind of tough sometimes when you're in a traffic situation. Or, as my father, so his shortcoming would be if you're in the express line at Myers and there's somebody with 30 things in their cart in front of you, he might not be quite so gentle. At one time, we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. But when the kindness and love of our God, our Savior, appeared, He saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of His mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom He poured out on us generously through Christ Jesus our Savior, so that having been justified by His grace, we might become heirs having the hope of eternal life. This is a trustworthy saying, and I want you to stress these things so that those who have trusted in God may be careful to devote themselves to doing what is good. And these things are excellent and profitable for everyone. I know that my dad's been very careful to teach me for a long time that doing the right thing isn't always convenient. Sometimes it's like the answer is no. You know, in our selfish way, I hate loving stuff. I really do. I don't like picking up stuff. I moved furniture for a long time. I had lots of manual labor, baling hay when I was a kid. I just hate lugging stuff. So when somebody comes to me and says, hey, will you help me move? I was like, no, but you can use my truck. Will that help? It's not convenient. It's not convenient to help all the time. But it's what God has asked us to do, and we're supposed to be ready for that. I've been so wrapped up in my own life you don't want to do it. Sometimes we're looking for a little redemption. I think a lot of times parents spend a lot of time with their grandkids trying to make up for what they might not have done with their own. I have a little boy in my life.
I fell in love with him when I met him.
And I care about him a lot. And I have to wonder, I didn't get it right 6 times in a row. Not well. How can I possibly help this young man? Much of it is just about time spent. Quality time. Trying to help someone see. And how many times have we been the hypocrite where we say, do as I say, not as I do, to our kids? And then wonder why they're in trouble or they've done something. With all authority, do what is right by them. Lead by example. That is a real challenge right now. And when you're somebody like me who spent so much time doing what's not right, and you're locked into some things that you just can't get away from, it seems. The cords of sin can only be broken by one person, and that is Jesus himself. They hold fast. My father taught me that being kind is the best way. That reaching out to other people and expressing your love to them and your caring. I've had conversations with my daughter who thinks it's a lot of you come walking and you say, hey, darling, how are you? And that term of endearment to you is an issue. And my mission is always to make everyone who comes in here feel loved, regardless of who you are. I'm never looking for a date, and I have one, and it's a good one. It's a permanent date, and it's a great one. But the idea is to make you feel loved, and that's something my father instilled in me. Whoever comes through that door, you are welcome. Anytime. He didn't really teach me that. He didn't tell me that. It's just the way he is. In those times of impatience that he has, or any of those little quirks, that's just a simple thing. Because what he does when no one's looking is still good character. And isn't that the key? What it is we're doing when no one's looking? That's the key. He taught me that. There's a lot of other things that he taught me that I don't think he realizes. Because I remember many years ago when it was clear he had kind of lost his faith in people. He was between churches and he told you about selling cars and doing the HVAC stuff and the selling that he was doing. And I remember one night being at home and I took every diploma that he had. From Grand Rapids School of Bible and Music, all of his certifications, and I laid them out on his bed. So he had to put them away, he had to look at them. With a little note that said, do what you're good at. Do what you're good at. When he came to this church, it was supposed to be an intro. I said, tell him to stop looking, Dad. You found your home. Don't plan on going anywhere. Don't plan on going anywhere. Do what you're good at. I hope that someday that my dad can maybe even share with me if he learned anything from Tim. I can't imagine that there's anything I could tell him that he didn't already know. Oh, yes, well, I don't want to guarantee that. He had 6 or 5 other kids, 3 or 4 other kids besides me, so that might have come later. But he is a good man. Regardless of his title here, regardless of, times when, now here's part of how he's just he's a kid too. Mom and Dad both had motorcycles, okay? I was not allowed to have one. But Mom and Dad both had them, and I think Mom had 2. She went in on another enduro with a friend of hers, a little dirt bike looking thing. And Dad would take me to baseball practice. I'd be sitting on my ball glove, and I'd be rapping on him. Just a minute. And I used to say to him, gun it, Dad. And he would haul. I mean, it's just a Yamaha 500. So to me, as a kid, it was fast when it really was. But man, we had such a blast doing that. But he was speeding. I remember the first time being on the golf course with him, seeing that 3-iron fly about 30 yards, and him having a word come out of his mouth that I was like, I slid over, and I didn't want to drive no more. And he said, are you okay? It's like, yeah, you swore. And I was scared to death, because the only time I ran ever, Luke, I can even imagine him saying something like that unless he was really, I mean, he was mad. He stopped the car, and he apologized to me for that. He said, you're right, and I'm sorry. Now, that didn't teach me not to swear, you know, because I'm a blue-collar guy. I work at a shop. It's just sometimes you're in the thick of it. I'm not going to make any excuses, because that's something that we all need to work on. Because I know you guys live lives too, okay? But my dad didn't intend to teach me a lot of things that I gleaned from him, and his example has been shining to me for a long, long time. And I hope that when he watches this, he knows that it is my intention to do him as proud as I can, and particularly where my faith is concerned. I hope that he's around for a very, very long time. Because we need him. We need him. I don't know if I'll ever be just like him. I put myself through too much dirt. I don't see the world the way he does. But I hope that today I've been able to share some things with you that help us all see him in a different light as a man, not just a pastor. And that we do what God said. Well, Saul was writing to Timothy and Titus in there about this is how we should teach the people. This is what we need to tell the little kids. This is where, and starting when they're young, this is what you need to do. This is how you need to be. And help them understand from an early age. Nowadays, it's so much tougher. The media is out there. And you cannot keep the crap from your kids. You can't do it. You cannot do it. Unless you live in, you know, out in the boonies someplace, and you don't need cable, and you don't need it. All they need is chores. That's all you get, chores. There's too much other stuff out there that gets in the way. So I challenge all of us to constantly look for opportunities to be an example to the world around us. Thank you guys for being here and listening to me. I appreciate it. You're good people. I know my father loves you all very, very much. There isn't one of you that he don't ask or talk about. Yeah, I ain't seen so-and-so, blah, blah, blah. He's always got something to say about the people here. He loves you. He loves this place. Thank you for being here for him and for me. You guys are all very gracious. I love you. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for our dads. And we thank you for our pastor. We thank you for the words of wisdom that he brings to us every week. We pray, Lord, that you would just bless him beyond measure today. I thank you, Lord, for the people that are here. And I ask that as we leave today, Lord, that we would be different than when we came. That we would look to your presence in our lives every day, just not when we're sitting here and we're asking you for help. But while we're working, with our families, when we're traveling, that we would know clearly that you're sitting right next to us. Thank you so much, Lord, for our family here. Bless us all. In your name, amen. Change my heart, oh God. Please stay. Thank you. sitting with us today. I pray for all of us, Lord, that you would bring this family again safely next week, and that the faces we haven't seen in a while will come. Lord, be with us all. Help us to lead by example. Help us to be strong enough in our faith that the answers would be so obvious to us, and that your guidance would be always sought after. We give this day to you, Lord, and ask that you would bless everyone. In your name, amen.